Welcome to United Unitarian Universalist Congregation. My name is Reverend David Kramer. Helping with this service today are Meg Whaley, Chair of our Religious Services Committee, Alex Chilson, our Director of Music, and Dennis Reynolds, our Director of Religious Education. You can tune into this service throughout the week on our website, unitedUUC.org. As we continue to offer worship safely and distanced, Meg says she was getting tired of seeing my bookcase behind me, so today I have taken a risk, and I have moved to the chimney and the stairway. Before we start, I have a couple of things to lift up. The first is that if you have a joy or a sorrow to share, please send me a message or contact someone from our caring committee. We are using the Tuesday United email post and this service to stay connected. This time of sharing is an important part of our church community. Sharing in virtual space is challenging, but together we will find new ways to be together. The second thing is that our annual meeting is set for 10:30 a.m. on Sunday, June 7th. This year's meeting will be held via Zoom. It is important that members consider this meeting this year, especially as we will be discussing how we move forward together as a religious community in the midst of a pandemic. If you are unfamiliar with the Zoom program, I would invite you to try it for coffee hour today at 11:30. And if you are still unable to connect or do not have a device that can enable you to do so, please contact me or Patty Vanderpool in the office. Annual meeting packets and proxy votes will be available as always. This is Memorial Day weekend, when we honor those who serve our nation in the military and those who have died in war. Please take a few moments to reflect on this service and this sacrifice. Words from Roland Gittleson. In the rising of the sun and in its going down, we remember them. In the blowing of the wind and in the chill of winter, we remember them. In the opening of buds and in the rebirth of spring, we remember them. In the blueness of the sky and in the warmth of summer, we remember them. In the rustling of leaves and in the beauty of autumn, we remember them. In the beginning of the year and when it ends, we remember them. When we are weary and in need of strength, we remember them. When we are lost and sick, we remember them. When we have joys we yearn to share, we remember them. So long as we live, they too shall live, for they are now a part of us as we remember them. And now please center yourselves for worship as Meg calls us in.
Good morning. Since the safer at home order was initiated, I have been trying to think of this time as a time of germination, as a planted seed tucked into the earth over winter darkness. It has been good to rest, and to plan and engage in personal reflection and work. We are still safer at home, but now it is time to be of use. Marge Piercy has a poem by this name, and it is a reading in our UU hymnal, number 567. I'd like to read it to you now. The people I love best jump into work head first, without dallying in the shadows, and swim off with sure strokes almost out of sight. They seem to become natives of that element, the black, sleek heads of seals bouncing like half-submerged balls. I love people who harness themselves an ox to a heavy cart, who pull like water buffalo with massive patience, who strain in the mud and the muck to move things forward, to do what has to be done again and again. I want to be with people who submerge in the task, who go into the fields to harvest and work in a row and pass the bags along, who are not parlor generals and field deserters, but move in a common rhythm when the food must come in or the fire must be put out. The work of the world is common as mud. Botched, it smears the hands, crumbles to dust, but the thing worth doing well done has a shape that satisfies, clean and evident. Greek amphoras for wine or oil, Hopi vases that held corn are put in museums, but you know they were made to be used. The pitcher cries for water to carry, and a person for work that is real. What is it that you have been dreaming, been planting in the darkness? What can you jump into head first? What can you do that has to be done again and again? What will you get your hands dirty for? Let's get the pitcher off the shelf and fill it with water. Let's engage in work that is real. Please join me in our chalice lighting. May this flame kindle within us the warmth of compassion, the glow of love, the fire of commitment, and the light of truth. Here together we scatter and nurture seeds of spirit, service, and community. Now please join me in hymn number 34, Though I May Speak with Bravest Fire.
My name is Dennis Reynolds, and I'm the Director of Religious Education here at United. Monday is Memorial Day. It's a really big and really important holiday. Today, to share with you all, I have a picture of my grandfather as he was serving our country as a sailor in the Pacific during World War II. And as I look at this picture of my grandfather as a young man, I think of all the experiences and memories that he had from that time in his life. I'm really lucky that I got to hear these stories from him, and it reminds me that everyone has a unique way in which they serve And it's really up to us to ask questions to make sure that these memories stay alive. So for all the RE kids and youth group friends, I really want you all to try to ask the questions so that you can have some memories to hold of your own from your family. Isn't that what Memorial Day is all about?
Now please join me in a spirit of meditation and prayer. Words today from the Reverend Sarah Lawal. Spirit of life and love, we are called together by love, a love deep enough to hold our joys and sorrows, our pain and loss, our doubts and fears. A love strong enough to steady us in the thresholds of life, awaiting the next blessing. May we find the courage to persevere in the storm, to see the holy and the broken, to stay present to life. When the pull to disappear takes hold with all its harsh realities, may we conjure up that fierce love to bring our hopeful vision into being, discovering the humanity, the bravery, goodness, still calling us forth. May we breathe into that story and make it come alive. May we be vessels of comfort and compassion. May we be vessels of peace and justice. May we be vessels of hope and healing. May love prevail. In the name of all that is holy, we pray. Amen. It is our practice in this congregation to share joys and sorrows each week, milestones in our individual lives. Louisa LeBlanc, who was hospitalized a week ago after feeling weak, has been found to have a bleeding ulcer. She has been moved to a rehab facility in Brookfield, where she is on the mend, but where visitors are limited. Cards and letters are deeply appreciated. Please watch your Tuesday email post for an address. Last Sunday, Maria O'Connor gained a new grandchild. Bryce Michael Whitty was born to Kelly and John Whitty of Maquanago. He weighed in at 8 pounds, 13 ounces, joining his siblings, Donovan, Clara, and Olivia. Congratulations and welcome to the world, Bryce. From last Tuesday's email, if you missed it, the adoption of Trent Avery Williams Lantau to Chad Lantau and Evan Williams was finalized. We are so honored to have this loving family as a part of our larger church family. And on this past Tuesday, Isabel Foucault turned 7. Happy birthday once again. Today, I also want to lift up these people who are part of this caring community: Jim and Debbie Brownlow, Barb Johnson and Sandy Zengler, and the distant but still with us, Stephanie Devlin. Once again, if you have a joy or a sorrow to share, please send me a message. It is important for us to stay together in this way. Let's hold all of these in our hearts and minds in the coming week. Alex will lead us in singing Walking With You. Each week we take up an offering, which is a sacrament of the Free Church, a sign of our covenant with each other and our commitment to the world. If you choose to give by text or online, please indicate whether you wish your gift to be counted toward your pledge or toward the plate. We are grateful for the many gifts we receive. Thank you.
Our next reading is number 560 in the hymnal by Dorothy Day, Commitment. People say, what is the sense of our small effort? They cannot see that we must lay one brick at a time, take one step at a time. A pebble cast into a pond causes ripples that spread in all directions. Each one of our thoughts, words, and deeds is like that. No one has a right to sit down and feel hopeless. There is too much work to do.
I know I've told this story before, and I also know that it is apocryphal, which is to say, it didn't really happen this way. But I like it, and it makes my point. It's about Henry David Thoreau, a strong influence in my life, even still, even after a lot of reading, as I have come to understand him to not be everything I had hoped him to be. Nevertheless, Thoreau was an abolitionist and a pragmatist, and the story goes that he once was arrested and thrown in jail for refusing to pay his taxes in protest of the Mexican-American War, which he saw as just a bad excuse to extend slavery. That much is true. He was thrown in jail for protesting the war. He was there for just a night before his friends bailed him out, and he wrote a book about it, Civil Disobedience, which has inspired untold numbers of revolutionaries from Tolstoy to Gandhi to Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. The apocryphal part of this is that while he was in jail, his friend Ralph Waldo Emerson is said to have walked by and exclaimed, "Henry, what are you doing in there?" To which Thoreau supposedly replied, "Waldo, what are you doing out there?" The message, of course, is that instead of just talking about doing something, Thoreau actually did something about it. I have long wanted to put that on a t-shirt. Waldo, what are you doing out there? Perhaps with a portrait of Thoreau on it. Right now, in the midst of a pandemic, I have heard people say that perhaps this is a not so subtle reminder to not do so much, to slow down, to take a break. I admit I am one who needs to be reminded of this all the time. But we have already talked about reading too much into the purpose of the pandemic, and I am also always reminded of Thoreau's apocryphal question, what are you doing out there? Even in the midst of a pandemic, even when the order or at least the recommendation is to stay home, even with social distancing and face masks and a still closed church, the work continues. The work of sustaining ourselves, the work of community, the work of spirit, the work of justice. From the book of James in the Bible, faith without works is dead. Or from Marge Piercy in the back of our hymnal, I want to be with people who submerge to the task, who go into the fields to harvest and work in a row and pass the bags along. Or Dr. Seuss, who says, unless someone like you cares an whole awful lot, nothing is going to get better. It's not. As you use, we say that what we do in the world makes a difference. Salvation does not come by a hocus pocus or a pledge of allegiance or even a heartfelt supplication. Salvation comes when we make things right. Even Martin Luther, founder of Protestantism, who lived through the Black Plague and who did not like the book of James, told his congregants when they asked how they should respond to their epidemic, I will ask God mercifully to protect us, and then I will fumigate. When I think of the work of this church, I start with our image of ourselves as a welcoming community. We are welcoming of people of many identities and orientations, but it takes constant work to keep on welcoming others who identify differently. We need to keep asking ourselves, who does not feel welcome? Why? I also think of our long interest in sustainability, the environment, green living. Our solar panels are a testament. And yet, what else can we be doing? How can we reduce our carbon footprint even more? How can we work toward change in our society, even in the middle of this? And I think of our commitment toward anti-racism. We now say we dedicate ourselves to this work through our agreed-upon covenant, and our anti-racism change team is making strides. Yet again, what else can we do? How can we make this a truly congregation-wide goal? I think this is connected strongly to our self-image as welcoming. How are we welcoming? How are we not? The work continues in whatever circumstance we find ourselves in whatever peril. There never is an ideal time to work for justice. If there were, we wouldn't need to work for it. One more quote. If not us, then who? If not now, then when? This has been used by all kinds of people, from Barack Obama to Ronald Reagan, and even Ivanka Trump, who attributed it to Emma Watson, Harry Potter actress. It actually comes from Rabbi Hillel the Elder, whose full quote is, "If I am not for myself, who will be for me? If I am only for myself, what am I? If not now, when?" Tablet, which is an online magazine of Jewish culture and ideas, says that "if not now, when" is maybe not even Hillel's best quotation. They make a case for another one. They say that when Hillel used to rejoice at the water festival in Jerusalem, he would say, "If I am here, everyone is here. But if I am not here, who is here?" In layman's terms, Tablet says, this is rabbinic for, "I am the life of the party. Put that on a t-shirt." May we all be the life of the party. May we all be doing something out there. Now, not when. Blessed be. However it is that you engage with the world in this time, whether it is by email or cell phone, Zoom, or clad in your own PPE, know that as you go, you are loved. Work toward justice. Find peace.